I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, Yahushua Messiah. My name is Ivan, and it is the 7th of October 2023, just after 4 o'clock on Saturday afternoon here in sunny South Africa, beautiful hot spring day. Today we're going to have a look at the story of the flood, Genesis chapters 7 and 8, where it gives us the details of the duration of the flood. This is a subject that I got into some time ago, and I've had a look around at some of the other teachings on the subject, and I must just say to you that I it's great difficulty agreeing with the mainstream teaching on the Noah flood story, in particular the duration of the actual time that Noah and his family spent on the ark. But I put it aside, and I did do a bit of a chart at the time. It was probably about 2 years ago, I don't know, maybe a year and a half ago. And I did share it with a couple of people, and I shared it on the forum at Ministry Revealed. And I've set it aside with the idea of maybe one day getting into a little bit more detail on that. And recently it came up again in the forum, and so I've decided to get it done, go through this the events that are described in Genesis 7 and 8 and explain why I disagree with the mainstream understanding of the story, and why I believe that what I believe to be what, and I just want to go through in some detail as to what I believe to be the correct understanding of the Noah story. So why do we do these things? You know, does it really matter at the end of the day? Well, I believe it does. I believe that it's truth begetting truth, and we should be seeking the truth in everything as far as we and I think it's important to get an excellent understanding of the word and the events that happened. I believe that if we understand more clearly what happened, what was, then we will understand more clearly what is to come, because what is to come is going to be based on what was. So for that reason, I believe it is important to get into some of the detail and to understand these things more correctly. I think to start off with, we should have a look at what the mainstream teaching is. The general understanding by most in the church is, and then we'll get into what I believe it should be. I'm going to try and keep this video to about an hour, and or even less if I can, and. I'm going to try and do it in a way that hopefully will keep your attention, and that that people remain, you know, intrigued by the word as we unfold it, and as we unfold the truths before us. All right, so I think if you go and do a search on the internet, you'll find there are many, many teachings on the Noah flood story. A good teaching to have a look at is in this particular site, How Long Was the Flood? These guys have done a tremendous amount of work on the subject, and they cover all sorts of points which include the conversion of what the Bible refers to as a cubit to today's dimensions. They're going to a fair amount of detail on that, which is quite interesting to look at. They've got a timeline, of course, which I'm going to have a look at, and it's in line with the standard interpretation. I will touch on that. They look at some other chronologies, but I really just want to focus on their side on two things, because it is in line with the general understanding. If we go to their timeline, the general understanding by most is that the time that Noah and his family spent on the ark was about 370 days. Some say 371. If you count the first day or the last day, and then of course some say 377, because they add the seven. They believe that Noah entered the ark on the day that the Lord warned him. He said, for yet 7 days the flood is coming, and they got on the ark immediately, so they include those 7 days. And then, of course, if you add the last day as well, then it's 378. So by far the greatest majority of teaching, or the greatest, the most common understanding, is that the time that Noah spent on the ark was 370, around about 370 days. This, of course, is all based on the understanding that in Noah's time, Noah had a calendar which was based on a 360 day a year. There's no evidence of such a calendar at all. In fact, it actually 360 days contradicts the movements of the sun and the moon against the stars. There is no 360 day. You can't find it anywhere in such movement. And we are told in Genesis 1:14 that the sun, moon, and stars determine our days, years, and seasons, and appointed times, etc. So this concept of 360 day prophetic year is largely based on an understanding where in the story, and we will be going into Genesis 7 and 8, we will come across this 150 days, that the water prevailed upon the earth 150 days, and it's considered to be 3 months of 30 days, and it's just a very convenient of a way of looking at it, and so the timings kind of look right. And so there's been this adopted idea that the 150 days is 5 months of 30 days per month, with based on a 360 day calendar year for Noah's time. When you take that view, then of course you've got 5 months where the water was rising, and then 5 months when it was receding. Now, there are clearly, again, there are some that don't consider these to be two separate 50-day accounts. The one is in Genesis 7:24, and the other one is in Genesis 8:3. But I'm fairly certain, it's clear that those are two separate 150-day periods. Okay, and not necessarily 5 months. Okay, so we are just told that there's 150 days period. We shouldn't be getting into preconceived ideas that should be a fixed number of months in any way. Because when we start to do that, that leads into all sorts of misunderstandings and preconceived ideas which we should avoid. So we can say safely that there are two sets of 150 days, where one way is described as the waters prevailed, and the other one is described when the waters receded. These guys, as is typically understood, consider the 40 days, because we're told that there was the 40 days that the rain was rain on the earth, 40 days, 40 nights, and they consider the 40 days to be part of the first 150 days. So they split the 150 days into a 40-day period, and the remaining period of 110 days for the waters prevailing. Again, that's a preconceived idea. There is nothing in the scripture that tells us that we should be, that the 40 days is part of the 150 days. Then there's a further, if you go into all the other breakdowns, they will then go, there's another 40 days mentioned, and later in the story we've got the seven days mentioned for the release of the second and third dove. And then of course there's a calculation of number of days which varies greatly. Okay, these guys have now covered two texts. They've gone into the Septuagint and the Masoretic text, and there are differences in the number of, in some of the detail, in the dates and all that type of thing. So they're just comparing the two in red text for the Masoretic text, and in black for the Septuagint. So the Septuagint, in my view, and my understanding in many areas, and studying the chronology, the Septuagint has been distorted in many areas where it comes to dates. So I do not trust the Septuagint at all from when it comes to understanding sequence of events, or more specifically the duration of events and the chronology. The Septuagint has has caused the changes in the chronology to suit their own understanding at the time when they did do the translation. So therefore, it is not as reliable as the Masoretic text, and which is far more stricter in adhering to the original. So when copying over, they were very strict in copying over the original text without influencing the text with their own preconceived understanding. So it does appear it is more reliable, I would suggest. So in this case, I would say that the 73-74 days that is typically calculated would be the one to look at, rather than the 93, and then of course the 23 or 29 days in some cases over there. Needless to say, all of this added up. So when you take the discount the 7-day warning, and you take the 40 days or the 150 days and the 150 days and the remaining days to the months that are given, they come to a total of 371 if you count the last day, etc. So my purpose of this video is not to go to explain how the in great detail how they come to these. There's another site that I had open. I'm going to pause this thing and just open up another site that I thought was pretty good and well worth looking at. Okay, I've opened up another site here. This was another site that I came across that also explained quite well that 377, 378 and 371, the various options that are currently put forward by most. And they've got it in table form, and they give a full breakdown there of again, these guys are taking the 40 to be part of the first 50, then the number of days between the 17th of the 7th month and the 1st of the 10th month, which are dates given to us in the script, and they just got a running total plus the 40 days that is mentioned again in Genesis 8, 6 to 7, and then of course there's the releasing of the first dove, the second dove, and then they've actually added an extra 7 days. I think they count another 7 days after the 40 days, I think, if I recall correctly. Anyway, somehow they come up with three sets of 7 days. And then, of course, the remaining 29 days, which will be the difference between two dates, the first of the 12th month and the first of the 6th month, etc. And then again, a difference between the first of the 12th month and the first of the 1st month, which is given to us as a day when the cover of the ark was removed. In any case, it's a date that is referred to in the text. And then the final date which we're given in the text is the 27th day of the 2nd month, and then the difference between those two on a biblical calendar would be 57 days. So there they got the total, and if the last day is counted, 71, and then of course if the first 7 days are included, then it's 377 or 378 if the last day is counted. So they give a nice breakdown of that understanding. So if you want to go and have a look at that to get an understanding of what the typical teaching is, those would be two good sites to go and have a look at. Okay, so that's just, I believe that understanding is wrong. Okay, these guys again, I don't think they go into detail. They also base it on a Noah's calendar being 360 day calendar. Okay, so that seems to be the main reason for this understanding having come about. So what I did was I went through the text and I've gone through from first principles, and I've also applied what I believe to be the correct calendar. Okay, if you want to understand the scriptures, you have to use the biblical calendar. The Hebrew calendar is probably the closest widely accepted calendar in use, which is based on the sun and the moon positions in determining the calendar. They don't use the stars at all. They use the equinox to determine the beginning of the year. it's very close. And in the biblical calendar, we have a situation where we've got two types of years. There's a short year and a long year. Okay, the short year, a 12-month year, but where some of the months only have 29 days in it versus 30 days for the alternate month, results in a year being 354 days, which is the total duration for the cycle of the moon, for 12 cycles of the moon, 354. But the solar year is 365. So what we've got this discrepancy, in fact, 364 is probably the correct number to use, which is the total duration for the year based on the stars. So the sun's year is 365, but the star's year is 364. There's a big difference between the two, and maybe one day I'll do a video on that and explain why there's such a confusion between the 365 and Enoch's mention of 364, which is a year based on the rotation of the stars. Okay, so the cycle of the stars is 364 cycles in a year, whereas in the same period of time the sun does 365 cycles, or 365 and a quarter, and the stars also do 364 and a quarter. But the moon does 12 cycles in 354. So you've got this 10-day difference between the stars and 11 days between the sun to account for. And so what would happen is, in every second or third month, there would be an additional month added, a 13th month, or if you want to call it a long month, but essentially an additional 30 days would be added to the year to bring things in line, so that the seasons don't drift out of line with the sun and the moon against the stars. So you've got to do this intercalation adjustment, which results in a longer year. So instead of a 354-day year for a short year, you add the 30 days, so you'll have a 384-day year occasionally. Okay. Now there are some that would argue that that's unscriptural, because no mention is ever made in the Bible of a 13th month. That's true. There is no mention of a 13th month. However, the Bible tells us that we must base our year on the sun, moon, and stars, and that additional 13th month is governed by the stars. The reason why I believe that the 13th month is never named as the 13th month in the Bible is because I believe the last month of the year was always called a 12th month. Even today, the additional month is inserted between the 11th and the 12th month, and it's called, 12A and 12B. So it's never called a 13th month in the Bible. For what reason, I don't know. But when it talks about the 12th month, what we don't know, was that the 12th month in a short year or the 12th month in a long year? And that's the problem that we have. Nevertheless, there are at least two stories now that I know of that will prove to us that there is occasionally a long year. The one is this story of Noah's Ark, I believe, proves that there is a long year when you understand it correctly. And the second one is the story of Ezekiel in chapters 4, where he's told to lay on the one side for 390 days and the other side, left side, for 390 and the right side for 340, which is and that all has to fit in within a year and a month. And the only way you can fit that all in within a year and a month is if there was an additional month, additional 30 days. There is no other way to fit it in. So the dates, the start date given and the end date given, are such that it cannot fit a standard 365-day year or a 354-day year in the case of a biblical short year. It can only fit a 384, and it's sometimes a 383 years. So 384, 383 year, let's call it a long year. So these two stories can only work out from a biblical date perspective when you consider them to have occurred across a year, or started in a year where there was an additional month, whatever you want to call that month. Okay. And when we start working through this, I think you will see that the logic will lead us to believe that this is the truth. We are looking at a long year, which is 354 plus the original 10 days. So, okay, This chart that I put together is, again, it's another little one of those eye tests. So if you're on a small screen, I'm afraid you're going to have to try and get onto a big screen to appreciate it. I'm going to enlarge it as much as I can. I'll move around within the screen so that I can explain what I'm trying to get at in the most logical way and without losing anybody. All right. So just first off, I'm just going to give an overall layout of the chart that I'm referring to. So I'm just going to zoom out. Don't expect you to be able to see anything in here. Okay, so I've got the year laid out from month one down to the to month 13, if it's the extra month, and then into the following year with dates, and I'm going to get into that detail. Then I've got the scriptures, the references. And I've just pulled out those scriptures. It'll just be easier for me to refer to, instead of jumping between the between two applications. I've got it all here, and then I've also got some of the Strong's definitions of some of the words that I want to highlight in these blocks over here. So that's basically the layout. I'm going to just zoom in again, and then let's have a look at what we've got here. Now we've got, all right, so getting into the chart, we start off with the first date that we're given in the text is the 17th day of the second month. We're told that it is the that the flood started. So in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, in the 7th day of the month, the same day were all of the fountains of the deep broken up and the windows of heaven were opened. So that's the start, that's the first day, that's the day when the flood started. Okay, so that's the first date that we're given, and the last date that we're given is the 27th day of the second month in the following year. Okay, that's down in, so the first one was in the 600th year of Noah, and this one is in the 601st year of Noah. So in the second month, in the 27th day of the month, was the earth dried, and God spoke to Noah saying, go forth of the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. So that's the end of the flood. So those are that's the beginning and the end date that we're given in terms of the flood, the start and the end. And then we've given some detail in between. I just need to highlight there are specific durations mentioned, and there are only these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 in the scriptures, 6 specific durations. Okay, it was 40 days, 150, 150. This one was associated with prevailing, 150 associated with receding, another 40, and then the 7 and the 7 between the doves. There is no other duration mentioned. So they've been underlined. There's the 40 days in Genesis 7:17. Then we've got the 150 days associated with the prevailing, and then we've got another 150 days associated with the return. That's all the receding, and then we've got 40 days. Yeah, it's in the story here. Sorry, I just pulled it out separately. 40 days. Associated with opening of the window, and then we've got 7 days related to the second dove, and 7 days related to the final dove. So those are the only durations mentioned. Okay, and we need to consider them now, and those all need to fit in between the two dates that we've got. So the question is, now how do we deal with these durations? Are any of them running sequential? Are any of them running in parallel with, as suggested in where 40 days is running together with 150? Or is it actually supposed to be considered as a sequential event where the 40 days happened before the 150, which happened before the next 150, which happened before the final 40? And so each of these days sequential. If that is the case, the total adds up to 394 exactly. And 394 is exactly a full year, a long year, and 10 days. So we know that we have to have a year and 10 days of some sort because of the last date. It's given as the 27th day of the second month in the following year, where the start was the 17th day of the second month, so there's a 10-day difference. So we're going from the 17th day of the second month in one year through to the 17th day of the second month in the following year, a complete year, plus 10 days. Now, recently there's been a suggestion that this was based on in the forum where it was considered the year was considered to be a short biblical year. In other words, the 354, where it would be 17th day of the second month to the 7th day of the second month in the following year, 354 days later, plus the 10 days, which would be a total of 364 days, close to a solar year, which looks very attractive and a possibility. But the problem is, you will not be able to get these numbers fitted in unless you start going, unless the 40 is part of the 150, and even then, the total number of days does not add up to 365, because if that 40 is part of the 150, well then we can just take 40 off this, and that's 354 days, and we know that it must be, well, it includes the extra 10 days, so it must be, if 364 days was the number, we short 10 days. Okay, so there's 10 days missing in the equation, so it could not have been a short year. A short year just doesn't work. Even if you take a short year and you consider the 40 days to be part of the 150, it doesn't work out. It just the only way it works out is when we consider a long year, a 384 day, plus of course the 10 days, so 394 day, and then the numbers pan out exactly. And that's what I want to just go through and explain why it is that this is the most logical understanding of the text. Okay. Now, before we get into the detail of each of these steps as we go along, we need to understand the way that the story is written in Genesis 7 and 8 is not necessarily 100% sequential. In other words, it's not starting at the beginning and going to and our story from beginning to end finished. No, it jumps around a bit. You know, we get a situation where Noah is told to get into the ark, and within 7 days the rain's going to start. That's the first bit. Okay, and Noah does according to the east commands, and then later on, so that's the first bit, and then it jumps, and then it's suddenly it says, it came to pass after 7 days the waters of the flood were upon the earth, and then it starts again, the story starts again now in a little bit more detail. So in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 7th day of the month, the same day where all the fountains of the deep broken up. So it starts again after having mentioned that that there were 40 days already, that the rains were on the earth for 40 days. It goes back into sort of a rerun of that detail, but perhaps a little bit more detail in it. And then it goes on to say, and in self some day Noah and Shem and Ham and Joseph and the whole family get into the ark. So you can see it's a repeat. Yeah, they got into the ark already, and then they get into the ark again. So the story is not and this is not the only place you'll see it in the story. You'll see it jumping around in getting into some detail. Maybe mentioning the end and then going back into some detail, then going back into the end again, and we see that quite a bit in chapter 8, where there's the whole story of the 40 days which led up to the releasing of the dove, and then it mentions about the cover being removed. You know, so there's the covering of the ark being removed after the doves are released. So when you read the sequentially, you think, well, the doves were released and then he moved the cover from the ark, and then the ground was dry, and that leads to a tremendous amount of confusion. If you read it that way, you're not going to get you get into trouble getting the correct sequence of events in according to the days that were given to us. So that's the first thing I just want to get across to the listener of this video. is that you cannot read chapter 7 and 8, the story of the flood, in a sequential story order. You've got to read into, you've got to understand what the text was saying at the time and get into the understanding of the words, the actual words, because there's a few words where it refers to and the earth was dry when the English word is dry, but you discover that when you get into the Hebrew word, it was nothing to do with dry. Okay, so that interpretation of some of these has created some confusion, and I'm going to go into detail of that. Each one of those instances, I'm going to mention them as I go into through this timeline. Okay, so overall, I just want to give you an understanding of the colors. Okay, so we've got the months with each alternate color in a different month. Okay, going through. I've included in this column the number of days in a month. Now, in a biblical calendar, we've got a switching where a month has 29, then 30, 29, and 30, alternating in terms of days. Typically, the extra month that's added is 30 days, and then continues again in the new year with a new sequence of 29, 30, 29, 30. So that's what's reflected there, the total or number of days in a particular month. Okay. Now, just out of interest, the question is, should the first day have 29 or 30? Most times, if when I've done the checks, it's 29. There are a few instances where it is 30, but in this instance, the numbers do not pan out if you start off with 30 there. Okay. So you can play around with these numbers yourself and you'll be able to see that that is the case. So what we've got here is, all I've done is I've broken up each month where there is given some detail. We've had to break it down into numbers. So this column in that month, month two, those would add up to 30. Okay. This one here would add up to, that's for the month three, those two numbers add up to 29. And then, of course, there's no detail there, so those are all. Then this one here, those two numbers there add up to 29, and so on. And that is, so that's the analysis. So I'm just giving a breakdown so that I can get into explaining when these events, because some of these beginnings of the 40 days didn't necessarily occur at the beginning, very beginning or ending of a month. There was, like in the case of the 40 days, the 40 days started on the 17th day. You've got to include the count of the 17th day of the second month. So we know that if there was a warning, of 7 days, the warning must have taken, we're not given the 10th day of the second month, but we know it must have occurred on the 10th day of the seventh month, including, so that's 10th day of the second month is the first day of the 7 day warning, so that the 7 days could be complete by the 16th day of the second month, so that the 17th would be the first day of the flood. Okay, so there has to be 7 before, for there were yet 7 days. And there is a verse that, and I've not included it here on the chart, but there's another verse that said after 7 days, the 40 days, and it might actually be, I don't know, we might actually find it still, but it's definitely after the 7 days, 7 days complete, and then the start of the 40. Okay, so we've got, so in this month too, we've got 14 days left. If you take nine days up to the 10th day, then starts the seven days would be from the 10th day forward to the 16th day. And if there's 30 days in the month, there's 14 days left in that particular month. Okay. Then in the month three, we know it's 40 days. So there would be, we would consume 26 days of these 29 days to complete the 40 days. So that's why we've got the 14 and 26, which gives us a total of 40 days. So by the 27th day of the third month, that's when the ark lifts off the ground. Now, this is something now very important that many people miss. And so this is where we have to go to Genesis 7. And the flood was 40 days upon the earth, and the waters increased and bare up the ark, and it was lifted up above the earth. So what had happened, the ark, for the first 40 days, the ark is sitting still on the ground, hasn't moved one bit. The waters are rising, it's raining, the floodgates are open, the windows of the heavens are open, the fountains of the deep are burst open and the water is busy rising up, and it takes 40 days before the ark lifts off the ground. Okay, so that's so we must take note. It's then we're getting into the next period where we're told in where the waters prevailed, and which one is bare up? Okay, so it's bared up. So the waters, this now the ark is lifted, but the mountains are not yet covered. So the water continues going up and up. So this whole yellow block is the 150 days of the water prevailing. Okay, now prevailing means to have strength. So if we just have a look, prevailed, the waters prevailed. It's to be strong, it's to be great, to be mighty. Okay, so to be valiant, it's an indication of this was a rumbling. This was water coming out in full power. Okay, so 150 days of prevailing. So where we're told in Genesis 7:24, we have covered it briefly. The waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. Okay, so it's prevailed. Later on, we're told in Genesis 8:3, the waters returned from off the earth continuously, and after the end of 150 days, the waters were abated. So this is a whole different 150 days to that 150 days. Okay, so the yellow is the prevailing, and the green block, which, and I'll get, and I've separated into two portions in that 150 days. There's two things happening within those 150 days, and I'll get into that now. So this is the receding. This is when the waters start turning back, and it takes 150 days for the waters to get down to ground level again. Not necessarily totally dried up yet, but completely abated. So it's returned to where the Lord had decided to bring it back to. It wasn't back to its original. In other words, the oceans are far greater after the flood than pre the flood. There was more earth, dry earth before the flood than after the flood. So when it got to a point and the Lord decided that's where it's gonna, they're gonna stop, and then the receding stopped. Okay, and so just a little bit of sideline thing there. Right. So we've got, if we go into Genesis 7:18-20, we'll find that the waters prevailed and were increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark went up upon the face of the water. So this is when the ark is now lifting and lifting and lifting. Okay, it's off the ground and it's lifting, okay? And then it continues, and the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth, and all the hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. Okay, so now it's got to the point, it's got to the point where the mountains are all covered up, and then it continues to cover up by a degree of 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail. So once it got to the highest mountain, it then continued to cover by another 15 cubits, which is about 7.5 meters. It's about 25 feet, so that it covered the highest mountain, above the highest mountain. Okay, now the great debate is, which one is it, Mount Everest as it is today, which is the highest mountain, or was it some other mountain? And did Everest, as some suggest, actually form during the time of the flood, during, because of the pressure of the water, etc.? There's been some debate on that. The scope of this video is really doesn't really allow for getting too much into that. I personally don't believe that was the case, that the highest mountain that the word is referring to was in fact Everest, and that Everest wasn't created during the flood, but it was already in existence before the flood, and that is the highest mountain that was covered by a space of 15 cubits. Nevertheless, what's more important to understand is this 15 cubits, and that's why I've highlighted it, because it's later on it's evident why the Lord told us. You see, we have to understand that the Lord tells us things not because for no reason. There's a very specific reason. When he tells us there's 40 days and 150 days, 150 days and 40 days and 7 and 7, he tells us that for a very specific reason. We need to understand that's not, he's very efficient with his scriptures, with his word. So there's a reason for this 115 cubits that's mentioned here, that the waters prevailed above the highest mountain. Okay, and I believe we will see the reason for that a little in a short while. Okay, so we've got a situation where the water is prevailing, and then we're told that in Genesis 8:1, okay, now it comes a little bit later on in the story, and this is where things get confusing, because we're told in 7:24 that it prevailed for 150 days, and then later on we're told that God remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him on the earth, on the ark, and God made a wind pass over the earth and the waters assuaged. Okay, and then the fountains of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. Now something happened here. This was the stopping of the inflowing of water. Okay, this is what's happening here. The fountains of the deep are closed. The windows are closed. The rain stops, and now we need to understand. Hey, what's going on here? What is this wind that passes over? And when you go into a little bit more depth and understanding, you'll find that this wind, sorry, that line should be there. Wind, this word translated wind is actually ruach. It is H77307, which is the same word translated spirit in Genesis 1:1. Let's just go and have a look at that. Just go to Genesis 1:1, where and I'm going to switch now to KJV Plus. The earth was without form and void, darkness upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved. So the Spirit, H7307, Spirit of God, moved upon the face of the waters. And that same word is translated wind in Genesis 8:1, it's translated made a wind. So I believe what we need to understand here is that this is the Spirit of God moving over the face of the waters, not necessarily a wind as in the way we understand wind to be a storm wind. This is the Spirit moving over and saying, bringing about a calmness, just like Jesus stilled the waters with his disciples when they were in a storm, and he commanded and the waters went still. Same thing happened here. God commanded by the power of his Spirit that the waters must be still. And evidence of that is in this word assuaged, which means it means to appease, to make, to cease, to pacify. Okay, so this is not causing it. Just now you've got a mad raging waters, huge big waves, storms, probably it's chaotic, and then he stills it. Now in that stilling process, the effect is the water level drops as well. Not because it started receding, not because it started going out of the system, so to say. We've got a situation where the fountains of the deep are closed, the windows of heaven are closed, but the water's not being taken out yet. It's just being calmed down, and that's what's happening here. And then what happens? And it's during this 150 days. We don't know exactly when the waters were assuaged. We cannot say exactly when. But what we are told is that on the 17th day of the 7th month, that the ark rests, and the word is in King James is on Mount Ararat, but the word could also be over. In other words, this was not necessarily coming down and touching the ground and settling down. This is a settling down, a resting. Because the word, in fact, I've got the word here, Genesis 4, and the ark rested in the seventh month, on the seventh day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat. By the way, the mountain in Ararat is on its own, the one in Turkey, and it's not surrounded by mountains. There's another one of those things that makes us believe that the Ararat one in Turkey was named after the original Mount Ararat, which is in Himalayas in Tibet, and I believe that is where the real ark laid and probably is today, and it's been hidden, that the ark is really in Tibet. And there's a, if you go and have a look on the internet, you'll find that there was a one time when I remembered a fair amount of information on the ark in Tibet and people that had found evidence of the ark in Tibet, and all of that is gone. I can't find it anymore. So I believe that is where the true ark is in the mountain, in the Himalaya mountains, at or very close to Mount Everest, in Tibet. Anyway, what we've got here is the ark coming to rest over or on, and this is where that 15 cubits comes into play. When we go and look at the dimensions of the ark, and this is where that other site that I referred to earlier, they went into a lot of detail on the size of the cubits and all those kind of things, but it's even you don't even need the conversions to understand this. We're told in Genesis 6:5 that the ark must be 300 cubits long and 50 cubits wide and 50 cubits high. That's the overall basic dimensions of the ark that Noah was given. Now when you go into some detail on shipping, you will know that there's a section that's called the draft, and that's the part that goes into the water, okay? And then the faceboard is the part that sticks out of the water, okay? So this ratio of faceboard to draft, in other words, how much sticks out versus how much sticks above, can vary from design to design of various ships. But for a very stable design, you want somewhere around halfway. You want half below and half above. It does two things. One, it's a very stable ship, and second, in big waves, you don't get you get situations where the faceboard is very small by comparison to the draft. But it's very susceptible to waves easily rolling over the deck, as opposed to a cruise ship, is the other way around. You've got this huge amount of ship above, and only 10 or 15% of the ship is below the water, and so they do that for reasons, because they want their cabins above the waterline, etc., etc. So there's different design constraints, but when we need to consider stability, and this was the criteria for Noah's Ark, was stability and to be able to get through this time of turmoil in the waters, it is most likely that it was about a 50-50 ratio. So about 15 cubits would have been below the water and 15 cubits would have been above. So when you consider that, and you know that the water was 15 cubits above the highest peak, that means when the water started to settle, the ark probably just touched the ground with its 15 cubits being below the water. It just touched, not to the point where it would break the ship, but just enough to hold it steady. And I think that's what actually happened here. When the waters calmed, God brought that ark over the highest peak, and it just touched the ground to, and that's what we're reading here. I think that's and that's the reason why we are told that the water was just 15 cubits above the highest peak, and we're given the dimensions of the ark. I think we can maybe reading a little bit between the lines, but I don't think it's a far stretch, because the reason why is if we in this 150 days, if it's not started receding yet, why else would the ark come to some sort of rest? You know, why else? What other mechanism would there be? The waters not actually started receding, because we're told that it prevailed for 150 days and it abated for 150, and the abating hasn't started yet. So by the 17th day of the 7th month, if this understanding is correct, the abating would not have started yet. And in fact, I think, I haven't actually, if I remember correctly, I think even if you combine the 40 with the 50, you would still, the 50 would, the abating had, still wouldn't have started, I think, by a few days before the 17th of the 7th month. If I remember correctly, yeah, it was 149. Yeah, it's 149 from there. So it's one. So the 17th of the 7th month is one day before 150 is complete. If you combine the 40 into the 150, then you've got a situation where the arc rests one day before the abating actually starts. So that leads a bit of a problem. So there's even if you consider the 40 to be part of the 150, you've got a bit of a problem as to why the arc would come to rest. I believe the reason is because the waters assuaged, they settled down, they calmed down. Okay, the waves were gone, and the whole thing came to a rest, and the arc came to a rest, so to say, stillness, just touching the ground, but not enough to break it up by the 17th day of the 7th month. And the calmness continues on to complete the 150 days. Okay. So then only after the 150 days, we're told that the... now, that's the end of the prevailing. Okay, then the beginning of the abating. Alright. We're told later in 8.3 that the waters returned from the earth continuously, and after the end of 150 days, the waters were abated. So that's the abating lasts a total of 150 days. We never, this is the interesting thing, and we're never told exactly at what point the fountains on the deep, or that the water started, was removed. Okay, we're just told that it abated for 150 days. So the only thing we can do is immediately after the 150 days is complete is to begin the abating period, the 150 days abating. So just going into the numbers again, and in terms of the counts, we can derive a date because of the 150. If we know that the 40 came to an end on the 26th day, so on the 27th day it lifted off the ground, and then we know that there's of the 29 there's 3 days remaining in the 3rd month. Then of course the full 30, the 29, the 30, and then we've got the 17 days to the resting of the ark, and then of the 17 of the 29, then we've got 12 remaining of that 29 plus another 29, and when you add all of these numbers together, it comes to exactly 50. And the interesting thing is, it ended up being exactly complete at the end of one day before the end, so of the 8th month. So the abating started on the first day of the 8th month. We're not told that as a date in the scriptures, but by understanding of the 150 following the 40, etc., it could only have started abating on the first day of the 8th month. Okay. And then it starts abating in the meantime. Then we are told that on the first day of the 10th month, so from the first day of the 8th month to the first day of the 10th month, that's exactly 2 months, then the mountaintops were seen. And we're told that in Genesis 8.5. So Genesis 8.5, and the waters decreased continuously until the 10th month. And in the 10th month, the first day of the month, the tops of the mountains were seen. So, of course, there's a limit in terms of distance that you can see before your eye cannot see beyond the horizon, and you can't see mountains. So if they were in a certain position and they started seeing mountains, mountaintops, That means that there must have been other mountains within visible distance. And the interesting thing, the observation is, when you go to Mount Ararat in Turkey, there's no, that is not the situation. These guys go into a lot of detail on that. That's why I mentioned, let me just go back there. These guys go into a lot of detail on that whole concept. So have a look at that. Okay, so we've got this abating, and then from this point on, now, so up until, yeah, there's no lander visible for 2 months after of abating. There's no lander visible. Then after 2 months of abating, a total of 30 days, because we, yeah, 30 days, because the first day of the 10th month, I said 2 months, it's not 2 months abating. No, it is. It's the 8th month. It's the first of the 8th month plus the 9th month. Yeah. So it's the... Let me just... Is that right? No, I'm sorry, I'm getting myself into a knot here. There's 29 of the... It's the last day of the 8th month, not the first day of the 8th month. The first 29 of the eighth month is ascribed to the 150 days. From the last day, the 30th day of the 8th month, from the 30th day of the 8th month forward is the abating. So it's about a month, in other words, 30 days before the mountaintops are seen on the first day of the 10th month. So there's 30 days, about a month, the whole of the 9th month plus that day, total of 30 days of abating. Okay, sorry, my error in the split there. Okay, so then we have continued, now our land is visible for the remaining 120 days. So the remaining 120 days of the 150, land becomes more and more visible as it continues to abate. Again, that's just a arithmetic, so just adding up the 1 day, that then the each total number of days for there, plus the first day of the first month, that 1 day, we're told first day of the first month in Genesis 8:13, and it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month, on the first day of the month, that the waters were dried up. That word is not dried up really, but it's translated dried up, from the earth. And Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the earth was dry. And that word is not actually, doesn't mean dry when you go to the original word. So what we're seeing here is that, I'm going to go into that. So what we're seeing is that by the first day of the first month, we've got a situation where the water is gone, but the earth is not dried up yet. It's just a wasteland. When you go and look into the original word that was translated dried up here is H2717, okay, and it means to make waste. It does mean to, you know, so it's got to parch, drought, that is, it's a desolate, to destroy, to, it's decay, okay. It's desolate, it's to make waste, okay. I'm gonna just bear with me here, and it's used twice, okay. So the waters was made waste, and the face of the earth was dry. It's not dry, it was a wasteland, it was a decayed situation. You got to picture in your mind the ark is what all they see about them is no more water, and they just see everything that was on the ground is now rotten. All those trees and that were under the water for a year are all dead, and they're rotting, okay. It's just a waste marsh mush, okay. That's what's being depicted here. There was no dryness. It was like a, would have been like a marshy type situation. The reason why we know that is later on we are told that in the second month, this is the first day of the first month, and in the second month, on the 27th day, the earth was dried. And there we have a different word for dried. It's H3001. Which means to make dry. This is the real dry, okay. And very interesting, when you do a search on this word, if you go to Job 14:11, both of these words H2717 and H311 are used in the same sentence, and it says the waters, and it was referring to it's not in context of the flood, but I'm just pointing out the understanding of the words. The waters fail from the sea, and the flood decayeth and drieth up. There's the decayeth. You see, the word H2717 is associated with the word decayed, rottenness. And then we've got H3001, which is dry. So the two words are two different contexts, two different pictures. The one is a situation, okay, the water is gone, it's no longer a sea anymore, but it's still a marshland, it's not dry, it's a waste, it's a wasteland, it's a decaying situation. Okay, and then it takes from the first, it takes from the first of the first month till the 27th of the second month before it's actually dry. Okay, 22nd of the second month, until the second month, the 27th day of the second month, the earth is dry. So from those, and when you read it in context of all the other events, it kind of makes sense, because we've got the water abated. Noah doesn't step out of the ark, he just removes the covering. Okay, on the first day of the first month, he takes the cover off. Okay, does nothing else, and he waits 40 days. He doesn't get out of the ark, he doesn't send anything out, he doesn't send the raven out, he waits 40 days. Okay, and then we're told after 40 days, so that we have to go to the story where of all the doves and that are going out. So Genesis 8:6, and it came to pass at the end of 40 days. This is the second, not that 40 days there. This is another 40, the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made. Okay, so he opens up the window after 40 days, and he, on that same day, there's no waiting there now, it's 40 days, and he sends forth the raven which went to and fro until the waters were dried up from off the face of the earth. So in other words, this raven goes to the ark and back, and to the ark and back, and comes back and forth, and never really comes to an end. It doesn't give us the end story of the raven, but at the same time, and also it's at the same time sending the raven, and also he sends forth a dove, okay, and the dove can't find a foot to place, and it comes back, and she returned unto him, and he pulls her into the ark. Okay, so that's after 40 days. He sends the raven, and he sends the dove, and the dove comes back. Okay. So then he waits, then he stayed yet another. Now it's not yet another, in other words, there wasn't a previous 7 days. That word other is incorrect. It should be just he stayed, waited 7 days, and again he set forth the dove. So he waited 7 days, and he sends the dove again after 7 days, and this time she comes back with the olive leaf in plucked up. Okay, so now he knows that the waters, things are, after the, within this 47 days, there's now an olive leaf that actually, so some of the trees have started to recover, and they're starting to put out their leaves, and the dove brings back. So he knows that the situation is getting very close to the point where they can step out, and he waits yet another 7 days. So that's, and he sends out, so yet another 7 days, and he sets forth the dove again, and this time she doesn't return to him. Okay, so that's after yet another 7 days. So there's only two sets of 7 days. 40 days sends out a dove, waits 7 days, sends out a dove, waits 7 days, sends out a dove, and she doesn't return. And that's it. And then we're told on the 27th day that the Lord says he can step out. So in other words, after the 7 days of the dove not having returned, so the dove doesn't return, he knows that the waters have abated, and the Lord says to him, so in the second month of on the 27th day of the month, the earth was dried. Okay, the real dried. And then God spoke unto Noah, saying, go forth up from the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. So he's told to leave the ark on the 27th day of the second month. And that would have been after 394 days. In other words, on the 395th day, if you want to call it that. I've not included that 394. So that's where I believe that is the true understanding, is that the total duration was 394, which was a long year, a biblical long year of 384 days, plus the 10 days going, bring us from the 17th of the second month through the 27th of the same month in the year after the flood started. So and that's that is a situation where the 40, the 150, the 150, the 40, the 77 are all sequentially added up, and it gives us exactly a total of 394 days. Now, just another interesting thing, if you take from the beginning of the 7-day warning, so from that 10th day, if you take from the warning and you include the warning and a few other things, I need to just mention here, we know, we're told that after they leave the ark on the 27th of the second month, that Noah builds an altar and God enters into a covenant with Noah and the rainbow is given as a sign. We're not told exactly when that happened. We're not told how long after they stepped out of the ark did that happen. We know it obviously would have been fairly soon. I've come to understand that the 15th day of the third month is what I believe to be covenant day. There's evidence that all the main covenants that the Lord entered into, those with Abraham and others, Jacob, and there were other covenants that he entered into, occurred on the 15th day of the third month. I also believe it is the very day that Jesus was born, on the 15th day of the third month, which, if you count correctly, from Passover, would be the true Feast of Weeks, the Leviticus count of 7 weeks, and being 49 days, and then the 50th day would be Feast of Weeks. So that is not too far away. It's only 18 or 19 days from when they were told to step out of the ark. So I think that's a fairly reasonable amount of time to get together, to find their feet, and to build an altar. And I believe that this is probably the day that the covenant occurred. If that is the case, okay, and that is my interpretation, or that my interjection there, okay, there's no scriptural evidence for that. But if that is the case, then the total time from the beginning of the warning to the covenant would have been exactly 420 days. So that's just a little bit of extra interesting observation if you really want to look at it from that perspective. Okay. All right. So I think that's. I hope that was clear, and I hope this blesses you. I think that pretty much covers everything that I wanted to cover on the subject. Please, get into it yourself and have a look at it critically. Don't accept what others have just said. Get into the scriptures. Look at the original meanings of the words. And if you do that, I'm sure you'll come to a conclusion, as I have, that the standard version that the church, that most of the church teachers with regards to the 370 just doesn't work, and they are required to bend things and to leave things out in order to make it work. So with that, God bless you.